One of my goals with this business is we really want to start to reaching out to parents of younger children. Not, you know, on an academic side it's good, but more importantly on a financial side, because if we can hit the realities of what a college education costs early on, and then we can help them position themselves and save in the right places so they don't ruin their chances of grants and scholarships based on how they save their money, and then also prepare them for the stage after college, which is your own parents' own retirement and financial goals and all the other things they want to do with their lives, the earlier that you can start this process, the better. So one of the things that one of my goals as a business owner is to really start to reach out to families of, you know, parents of younger kids or even students before you get on this path. Because right now, how many of you guys have jobs? Okay, a couple of you guys have jobs. When you got that first paycheck and you went, oh my gosh, this is such a large amount of money, what am I going to do with that amount of money? And then 6 months later you go, well, wait a second, this isn't a lot of money at all. How can I do everything I want to do on this amount of money? So part of what we do is financial education and teaching people how to manage their finances, how to do it in a way that's not stressful and actually a little bit fun. And so you don't, you know, human nature being that it is, whatever we get one day, 2 days later, it's not going to be good enough. So now we want something bigger and better, and which is a wonderful thing. But with your money, that can cause some real problems. So I'm so excited to have Jackie here because she is a parenting expert, and she's going to talk about helping your children relieve pressure and stress, which I think as parents will help you relieve pressure and stress. So take it away.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. My name is Jacqueline T.D. Nguyen, and thank you for having me here today, Chelsea. So the topic today is helping your children relieve pressure and stress. Before I get there, I wanted to show you one statistic. Research and statistics shows that right now the average teenager of today has the stress and anxiety level of a 1950s psychiatric patient. Whenever I say that to adults, we always are a little surprised. We're like, but can I ask, does that sound about right? High school? When I talk to a high school student, when I talk to a college student, they give me this like, that's about right. Feels about right. So this is what we're dealing with today, and this is why this presentation is so important to me. But before I get there, I want to know how many of you feel your children are experiencing too much stress and pressure? How many of you guys, you feel that are in college, in high school, do you feel like you're maybe experiencing too much pressure and stress right now?
Yeah.
You do. Okay. And how many of you here would like to reduce that? Learn some techniques. Teach your children for yourself. Awesome. Then you're all in the right place. So before I get into that, I wanted to share a little bit about me so that you get to know a little about me. Would that be okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. So today we're going to talk about stress. I'm going to show you how stress affects your body. We're also going to learn how to give you some simple tips to reduce stress. Okay, so as I talked about earlier, I graduated from UC Irvine. I was a straight A student in high school, was in leadership, was part of the theater department. I did everything in high school that I was supposed to. I graduated UC Irvine debt-free in 4 years. I went on to travel, like I talked about, around the world for a year. It was the best experience I ever experienced. It was also the craziest time of my life. I backpacked by myself, no one else. I made amazing friends. I had amazing adventures, as well as things that I would not want to experience again, like in a third world country in Vietnam, a bus breaking down in the middle of the night because we had too many passengers in the bus, and we all had to get out and push it up a mountain in the dark with no lights because we couldn't be in the middle of the road. So I jumped out of a perfectly good airplane for the first time during that adventure. After that, I went on to get married. I have two beautiful kids. My daughter is now 13 years old. I have a teenager, and my son is 10 years old. I went on to study at the top leadership schools in the country, to learn about leadership development, emotional intelligence, communication, engagement, how to get your employees, how to get your family engaged, to do what they want to do as well as what you want to do. I'm also certified master in neurolinguistic programming. If you don't know what that is, have anybody heard of Tony Robbins? Okay, well, 90% plus of what Tony does is neurolinguistic program. It's about how you communicate with your brain, and where that's where it starts. In actuality, I actually am under his lineage. So my coach, my trainer, was trained under Tony Robbins. So a lot of what I do has to go right into the subconscious, where the habits and the behavior starts. I have spoken and worked with so many companies, children's services, attorney for law firms, and I've been interviewed on TVs and radio shows, and I've also written a number one Amazon bestseller regarding family leadership. You know, and what I've done is I've taken how successful companies, how they are successful, the Googles, the Zappos, the Time Warner, what they do to get such high employee engagement, and how we can transfer it to the family, because really your family is your business, right? You are the CEO as parents, and as the children, you want them to take over your wisdom, your experiences, everything that you've done in life. You want to share it with them so that they can in turn leave that legacy to their children. And so when you start thinking of yourself as that high performing parent leader, I believe in conscious parenting. I believe in collaborative family, just like you would want that kind of place to go to in your business. I also started my own radio show last year. It was because of my book. One of the interviewers who interviewed me offered me my own radio show on the station, on his network. I now have moved out of the network, and I host my own show. However, I've got two other radio networks syndicating my show. I'm also on iTunes, on Google Play, on Stitcher. So every week on Wednesday at noon, I interview really top experts to help parents navigate what it is that we're trying to do to make the best of our children. And I also have, for all of you college students here, I have once a week, I do a teen to parent talk, where I allow the college students, or even if you're not in college, just 18 to 23 year old, to share what's going on with your life right now. So that us parents can hear and feel directly from you what you're going through, what you need from us, and what advice you would give to the high schooler. So if any of you here are interested, those college students, and you want to be interviewed, it's a half hour show, talk to me afterwards. I'm also a keynote speaker, like as I've spoken on many, many occasions. Okay, so let's get into it. Stress. In a typical stress response, your heart rate goes up and your blood vessels constrict. Whoops, let me go back, sorry. Very sensitive. So this is why chronic stress is sometimes attributed to cardiovascular disease, because it affects your heart, okay? So we don't want to have that level of destruction in our body, where your heart is vessels are constricting, right? So, but when you think about it, when you are exercising, you're elevating all of this. Okay, so keep that in mind, because we're going to talk about that later. Okay, what some of the signs of stress, it doesn't start right away in the physical body, right? We know this. It starts really up here. Your stress starts in your head first, and how it comes out is that you might have memory problem. You might have a poor judgment. Other things are you worry a lot. That's on the cognitive level. Okay, on the emotional level, you might find your kid being a little moody. You might find yourself being a little moody. You might feel, some of here it says, irritability, short temper, agitation, feeling overwhelmed, sense of loneliness, isolation, depression, or general unhappiness. That's where it hits you emotionally. On a physical level, you might have aches and pains. You might have diarrhea, constipation, nausea, dizziness, chest pain, rapid heartbeat, loss of sex drive, frequent colds. So if you're getting sick a lot, okay, they say over 90% of diseases are caused by what? Has an underlying of stress. Okay, so whatever you're experiencing physically, look at what's going on with you in your mind. Check out what your cognitive level, even if it's moodiness, all these things are, physical is the last thing that it hits. On a behavioral level, eating, it affects eating a lot, more or less. Sleeping, isolation, procrastinating, neglecting, using alcohol, substance abuse is a huge part of it. Nervous habits, nail biting, pacing a lot, all these are parts of it. So start recognizing, these are little signs that you can see, look at from your children, if you see, and be aware, because it's easier to stop it when it's in the emotional, the cognitive, and the behavior before it hits them physically. So I'm going to tell you, so we all thought that stress was not good for you, right? So I'm going to show you three studies, and it's pretty powerful studies. So the first study, they tracked 30,000 people for 8 years, and they asked people, how much stress have you experienced in the last year, and do you believe that it is harmful for your health? The result of the study, it says people who experienced a lot of stress in the previous year had a 43% increased risk of dying. That's the people who thought it. This was only true for the people who felt that stress was harmful for their health. This is how powerful the mind is. People that experienced a lot of stress but didn't view them as harmful were no more likely to die. So this shows how you view something as bad, your body will start responding that way. So what this says is that the researcher estimated that over the eight years they were tracking death, over 182,000 Americans died prematurely, not from stress, but from believing that stress is bad for you. Now, they found this to be also true, like if you believe that you have a certain disease, if a doctor diagnosed you with something, people will actually start developing all the symptoms, because they'll go online, they'll look, and they'll start developing all the symptoms. Have you heard this? Mm-hmm. Right? And so this is why it's so important that as parents and as teenagers, you hear, you have to start really working on your mind, because it's the most powerful thing. When you believe you have something, when you believe something is bad, your body is going to react the same way. So I thought that was kind of cool. So if you estimate that is correct, that would make the belief of stress number 18 in the cause of death in the U.S., which is above HIV, AIDS, homicide, and lung inflammation. If you put that on the death statistic, you're crazy, huh? So can change the way you think about stress make you healthier? Well, those of you who needed facts and science says it can. So when you change your mind about stress, then everything else changes. Okay, so start thinking that stress can be exciting. That when your heart is pounding, right? How many of you, like, right before, who likes roller coasters in here? Okay, what do you feel like right before you get on that roller coaster? When you're ready, when you're strapped in, is your heart pounding?
It feels a feeling in my stomach, like when you're a roller coaster. I don't know how to explain it, though.
Right, so is that similar to stress, mm-hmm. kind of, when you think about it? Mm-hmm. But the difference is your mind is saying this is what?
Fun
and exciting, mm-hmm. right? As opposed to about that test that you're going to have tomorrow that you may not be ready, right? So that this is what I'm talking about. Your body is react that same way. But what happens is when your mind says that it's negative, then your blood vessel constricts. and that's where you start creating the physical symptom. But when you say it's exciting and fun, your blood is pumping because it's like that adrenaline is ready, it's going, it's ready. Right? So this is what you can help your children with. Think of this is something exciting that I'm experiencing. I'm going to be learning more. I'm going to be experiencing something different. Think of it that way. So study two, this is from Harvard University. Anybody heard of Harvard? Okay. So what they found is that, so they looked at participants, and participants were taught to rethink their stress response as something helpful, okay, to their performance. This is what Harvard's taught their test subject. That pounding heart is preparing you for action. And if you're breathing faster, it just means that your body's getting more oxygen to your brain. And the results of the study. Okay? The participants who viewed their response as helpful, their heart rate was still pounding, but their blood vessels, this is what's important, stayed relaxed, which is much healthier on your heart. It actually looks like moments of joy and happiness when they measured it. Okay, and so moments of joy and happiness is really good for your body and your brain, right? Is this important for you to start thinking? Yeah. So new science and revelation. How you think about stress really does matter. Don't try to get rid of it. We can't get rid of stress. Every day we're going to be experiencing something. So what you need to do is learn that it's not bad. Actually, that it's good. Think of a time at your life when you look back in it now, when maybe things weren't going good and you were scared. Now look back at it and think about what you learned from that experience. Did you grow? Find one little nugget that you can take that bring you forward. And just know that every experience in the future is going to be like that too. So say to yourself, when something stressful comes up, say this. This is my body. Everybody say this. This is my body.
This is my body.
Helping me rise.
Helping me rise.
To the challenge.
To the challenge.
Okay, so this is my body. Helping me rise to the challenge. Does that feel much better? So when you view stress that way, your body believes you, and that then the stress response become healthier. So that's the first thing you can do, is changing your mind instantly. Okay, so the last study, this one's really great. It tracked about 1,000 Americans from age 34 to 93. They started the study by asking, how much stress have you experienced in the last year, and how much time have you spent helping friends, neighbors, people in the community? I thought this was so important because as human beings, we like being with people, right? When we don't feel good, we reach out. When we feel good, we want to share our happiness. So as humans, we're not isolating people. So when you find people who are isolating themselves, you find them going downward even faster, right? And so as parents, it's so important to, that's why I think colleges, you know, want you to do community service because of this. One of the reasons because of the study. So then they use public records for the next 5 years to find out who died. I would not want to do that job, but I'm so grateful that somebody signed up for that job. So for every major stressful life experience, like financial worries, college, you know, any losing your job, right? The family crisis, it increased the risk of dying by 30%. But people who spent time caring for others, being around others, loving each other, talking, communicating, there was no stress-related increase in the dying. None whatsoever. But people who spent time, so what it's saying is that caring for people, being around other people, creates a resilience that we want our children to have. Right? As parents, all of us, we want to be able to have that resilience. So that no matter what hard times we experience, we're all able to bounce back from it. And this research, this study shows that before that starts happening, do the community service, be around other people, because you're going to see that that's how it builds your strength inside. So, 5 quick and simple strategies and solutions. Now, this goes to the physical level, right? You get it right now. Besides changing your mind, which I showed you what to do, changing your mind, what it is, the first thing I learned was pattern interrupt. Most of you, when you are feeling, let's say, sad, how is your body? Are most of you probably shoulders slouched down, right? Maybe looking down, head down. Everything is just kind of inward, kind of the saving yourself. So the first thing is to change that physical body. How do you respond in your body when you're happy? Do you stand up, look up, smile, right? So the first thing is to change your body. So if you're sitting down, stand up. If you are standing up already, go walk. Change your body. Look up. Remember what it feels like, what your body is creating, because it's all muscle memory. What it's like when it's in happiness, what it's like when it's in sadness, what it's like when it's in peace. Okay, this is how your body naturally, this is the habits, this is the behavior act naturally responds. So remember what it's like. So when you want to recreate those feelings, you put your body in those states of being. So you can also go take a shower. That's what sometimes you'll take a cold shower because it changes your state. Okay, so if your children are all of a sudden they're stressed about, they come home and they're stressed out, send them into the shower. Okay, if you can't do that, if you're out, send them to a bathroom and tell them to go get washed their hands in cold water. Okay, we're changing the environment, right? Have them get ice. Have them put hands on their ice. These are all ways to change their body state so that their mind can come back into their body. What happens when we get stressed is our mind leaves our body, literally, right? Because we're like that. We say things, we do things, and later on what we say is, that wasn't me that said that. I don't know what I was thinking, right? Because you weren't, it wasn't you. And so we're trying to get you back into your body so that you are conscious and doing some of these things. Go and take a shower. Rubbing ice on your hand, taking a hand wash that's cold water, standing, visualizing what you want to be instead, really, really helps. Moving exercise. This is what, you know, when we exercise, we develop
endorphins.
Thank you. Endorphins in our body that counteracts depression. It is proven that people who work out, like how many, we think about it, people that work out every day, what's the possibility you think that they have a chance of committing suicide? 0, right? What about people that are sitting on the couch, not moving from the couch, and just there? What are the chances of them getting into that depression and committing suicide? Because their endorphins isn't being released. And so they always say, if you're feeling stressed, if you're feeling sad, depressed, anything, go and exercise. This keeps that level of hormones going in your body so that you can counteract it. Also, I found out from a friend of mine who is a personal trainer, says that if you could take a 15-minute brisk morning walk before you start your day, you actually increase your metabolism. So those of you who are watching your weight or just trying to watch what you eat, take a 15-minute brisk walk in the morning. Changes your whole metabolism for the rest of the day. And excuse me. And I would think if it changes your metabolism, it's going to change your mind.
Smart.
Yep. The number 3 thing that you can do is breathe. We always tell people breathe. But I'm going to add to that breathing, because not a lot of people even know how to breathe when they're stressed out. They start hyperventilating. They don't even think about it. So what you want to do, thank you, is 3 things. This is visual, auditory, and kinesthetic. When you start getting stressed, you want to stop, close your eyes, and you just want to think to yourself, what are you noticing? What am I noticing? Visually, What am I noticing auditory? What am I hearing, right? If I close my eyes right now, I can focus in, I can hear the buzzing of the computer. I heard somebody back there moving around. I can hear the cars outside. What am I feeling? I can feel the clothes on my skin. I can feel the water, taste of the water down my throat. I can feel my heart beating. Do you see how that, if you focus, that's bringing yourself back into your body consciously. And that's how you can then think more clearly. And so when you see anybody feeling stressed or just getting really agitated, ask them, just say, focus. Just name three things that you see. Now close your eyes. Now tell me what three things that you hear and just focus on that. I guarantee you you're going to help them get out of that moment of stress, and you're helping them getting into their body again. And then you can start helping them move on to a better choice. The number two thing, and I had a difficult time, two or one, the number two thing is to meditate and center. And you know all the benefits of it. If you don't, you just have to Google it. But the reason that I learned that meditating and centering was so important is that it sets your body clock back to default. Right? So many of us are running through the day with our mind, our body on sprint. And our body thinks that that is normal. That sprinting is normal. So when you want to go back to calming, it doesn't know what that is because you haven't taught it how to be that, right? And so meditation doesn't have to just come in the form of sitting cross-legged and all, okay? Meditation is getting your brainwave in alpha state. So you could be walking with your dog in the park. You could be walking your dog around the block. Some people petting their animal really, really synchronizes them with that animal and gets them calm. For other people, it's just listening to some soothing music. For some people, it's just walking at the beach. Okay, so teach your body what default is. So when you need it to go back to that, it knows what it is. The number one thing that I found, because not enough people get this, how many people think they get enough sleep every night? No? Okay, well this is essential. It's the number one thing that can help you relieve stress. So many of us don't get enough sleep. Sleep helps us heal. It sets our biochemical back to balance. It helps us think better. We're clearer. And this was something that's astonishing too. A lot of, you know, children needs actually 10 to 12 hours of sleep. Teens, you guys actually need 8 to 10 hours of sleep each night to function best. But on the average, our teens are only getting 7 hours. Can you imagine every night? I think that's actually too high. I know high schoolers who are getting 6 hours of sleep. How can they function like this? And then you wonder why they're getting into substance, Adderalls and things like that to keep them going. And coffee. My daughter is in junior high, and she says, the 6th, 7th, and 8th grader are drinking coffee and they're not having breakfast to keep them awake. We're talking about 11, 12, 13-year-olds who are getting addicted to coffee every day and skipping breakfast because they don't have time for it and they don't have time to sleep. They think getting 7 hours of sleep is like, that's like a lot for them as an 11, 12, and 13-year-old. But they're saying 9 hours is the average for a teenager to even function. So think about that. So thank you for being here today. I hope that I changed your mind on what stress means and what it can actually do for you. I hope that I was able to give you some really great techniques to help yourself and your family member. And because you're here, I have a sign-up sheet. I'm offering any one of you a 45-minute complimentary magic session, and we can talk about what's going through in your life right now, and I can give you a specific strategy just for you or your family member. It's value. Usually I charge $250 for that, but when I do speaking engagement, I always offer it just because I feel like you gave your time to me, and I want to give my time back to you for that. You're also going to receive an 8-minute stress reduction guided meditation that I created that you can download on your phone. It's 8 minutes. That's it. You can pull over your car on the side and listen to it. It will guide you through to a place where you can now get that default that I talked about, getting yourself back in default so your body knows how to get back to that. Okay, so those are my two gifts for you. I have the clipboards. So I have a lot of openings for the next week. I always clear my calendar after my speaking engagement. So please sign up. I also have postcards if you want to know more about my radio show. It is a radio show and it turns into a podcast, so you can go back and listen to it anytime. It's on the internet forever. So thank you so much. If you have any questions, do you have any time?
Yeah, we have time. We have about 10 more minutes.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, it's 10:46. The next one starts at 11, so we can do probably 5-10 minutes of questions if anybody has.
Does anybody have any questions? Yes.
In terms of stress for children and the sleeping and everything, don't you think that that's kind of been a sort of parental school cycle that causes them to feel the need that they have to do all these AP classes and do all this stuff and stay up late because...
It does.
Like, my sister's kids go to South Pasadena, and mm-hmm. she says that, you know, someone's got to break the cycle, but everyone's taking, you know, 5 AP classes, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So, but kids, you know, I mean, kids don't necessarily choose that. It's something that I think that the school system
yep.
and the parent, well, especially since South Pasadena is a very small community, everybody knows everybody. So how are children, who we say are so young, able to break a pattern like that? Basically, the parents and the school system have created for them.
This is what Victor and I talk about, right? About how this school system has created this. And we, you know, it wasn't like this when we were younger. I don't remember going to school and, you know, having to perform so much extracurricular activity and sports and all these things. And so for me as a parent, it's a choice. You know, do I want to have children in this system that are going down the line of substance abuse eventually, because how else are they going to stay up and focus, you know, to do what they need to do? For me, I've chosen not to have my children in all these extracurricular sports. You know, they're running around from soccer to football to softball camp. I allow them to have one. I want their mind to be clear, to be able to focus. You know, like Victor said, even college, they're not looking at all those extracurricular activity. They're looking at the GPA and the test score. And those extracurricular are something maybe, I think, for, you know, so you have to know where your goal is. And this is what I have a 3-month program, and everything is about what's your vision. So many of us go with what the herd does, right? But what do you want for your children? But so you can't set goals if you don't know what you want for them, right? In any goal setting, you have to know what you want at the end. You've got to know where you are now and what the steps are there. So every parent is different. I can't tell you that, you know, because some parents, they really want. My parents, I was either going to be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. That's how Asian parents think. So they had this set thing for me. Well, I broke that mold once I got out of college, and I set my own goals. For my children, I talk to them, and I see what it is they're interested in. And we, as a family, we set what my vision, what my dream for my kids are. And then I talk to them, and we change that. And I know my children, they're not the ones that are going to be, you know, this high doctor 4 years and then med school and all these things. They're not, their mind isn't that way, not right now, and I'm not going to push them. So the answer to that is, what is your goal for your children?
Well, I know what my goal is, but it's like then, if my goal is just to have my kid take regular classes, well then all these other people that are taking AP and honors and everything else, well, then their GPAs will far be superior to mine who just went the you know, the middle of the road. So then when it comes time to choosing, I mean, I know he wants to be an engineer, but he has no idea where he wants to go to school. I mean, he's only in 10th grade, you know.
Yeah.
But that, I know he's very good at hands-on stuff. So, but if you just follow this course and you don't kind of have to, you know, you can say you want to set your own path, but then, okay, you got a nice path, but you got a GPA of 3.0, where are you going?
So that's where I would advise them to go, at, you know, talk to Chelsea, talk to Victor, and say, okay, he's in 10th grade, he wants to be an engineer, what's the path that we need to take? And then that's specific for him. Do you see what I'm saying?
No, no, I know, but I'm just saying, in general, though, you also see all these people, he hears his friends taking all these, oh, I want to take this because my friends are taking AP classes or something like that.
And see, that's where, as a parent, then you got to talk to your son and say, do you want to, because if their friends, what about his friends saying, hey, try this, you know, try this alcohol, try this drug with alcohol, it tastes really good. We got to teach our children to start thinking for themselves, what is it that you want to do? Because how they do anything is how they do everything. So if their friends are saying, I'm taking AP classes, you should too, or making them feel that pressure, what happens when their friends are saying, let's go do this, and it's not a good idea? So my answer to that is, talk to your son and say, what is it that you want to do about this? What do you want to do about college? I know, you take away what all your friends are saying, what they're doing. Take that all away. Okay, step back. Do some of these stress things, because the stress is bringing on some of, you know, because when we're stressed, we don't know what to decide. What do? We follow what the herd does, because we can't make that decision. We're so stressed and we can't think about it. So you got to help these children get back in their body. Help guide them to a point where it's like, what is it that you want to do if mommy wasn't here? If mommy wasn't telling you what you should be, how you should act, where do you want to be? If your friends weren't taking all the AP classes, what would you do? Just have that if question with him. You know, like, what is it? What if you could do anything in your life, what would it be? Give them that opportunity to have this, have them dream what they want to dream. And then you guys can work together and say, that's your dream? Well, this is what we dream. What, you know, you're going to find some really surprising things when you take away all that pressure. And this is what I'm talking about. That's the pressure that they're dealing with. Is all my friends are taking AP classes. All my friends are doing sports. I gotta do this. Take that pressure away from them. Have them really step into their body and be who we want them to be. That, right? We're raising these children. I know I raised my children. I want them to stand on their 2 feet, make their own decision, and love what they do. To have their own dream. Thank you. I'm so excited for your presentation. It's so funny, when I said, oh, wait, what do you want to talk about? I'm a big Tony Robbins person as well. And one of the things that I do, another way to sort of get out of your body, and this is, I don't know, has anybody